Audio Jungle. Welcome. Good morning. I'm Pastor Kim from St. John's United Church of Christ in Lyons, Illinois. I'm delighted you've chosen to share in our virtual digital worship online with us today. I hope that you are experiencing a blessed Mother's Day, those who are mothers and those who mother to others. We have a lot of those who serve as mothers in our communities and in our families. So make sure that you give those loved ones a call, reach out to them, have a Zoom conversation, or try something new today to let them know how much you love them. When I share at church on Sunday mornings, I always say, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And indeed, that is true. Wherever you are, whether it is in your living room or at your kitchen table or perhaps snuggled in your bed with your laptop, wherever it is, you are welcome here, and we are delighted to have you join us for worship. So I believe we have some announcements to share, and then I'll be back with you in a minute.
Good morning, St. John's family, and happy Mother's Day to so many of you out there, whether you're a mother, an aunt, a sister, a teacher, all the fabulous women in St. John's life. We hope that those in the area enjoyed your little gift this morning. Thank you especially to Beth Korda for diligently making those masks that we could share with so many. You are appreciated. Just a few announcements this morning. Last Tuesday was Giving Tuesday Now, a nationwide fundraising campaign for nonprofits, and St. John's raised nearly $600, so that's very exciting. Thank you to all that gave. This Monday, tomorrow, is our monthly official council meeting at 7 o'clock. Just so people are aware, council has a check-in every Sunday afternoon for those who can join, just to stay up to date and connected to one another. And finally, next Monday will be book club or fellowship hour, whichever way you look at it, at 7 o'clock on May 18th. So thank you again. Happy Mother's Day, everyone. Love you all.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you. High above my life, I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve.
Yeah.
Let us prepare ourselves, our hearts, our minds, our bodies, for a time of worship together. We remember that Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you, and I will come again. So we gather together from many places to know God's holy presence and love now and always. And Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. If you know me, you know God. So we pray to know God more deeply and intimately now and always. Jesus said, ask me for anything and I will do it. We ask for God's help to discern the right things, that we may fulfill God's will now and always. Jesus said, believe in me and follow me. So we ask God to help us to worship fully, believing and following now and always. Let me be in a time of prayer for all. Ever gracious, way-making God, we celebrate the gifts of your Spirit. You have not fed us a diet of shame or shrinking, but with the milk of your truth and have made us strong and faithful servants of Christ. You call us to take up the mantle of justice and follow wherever faith leads us. You fill us with strength and hope, and you invite us to share in the cost and the joys of discipleship. You promise us splendor and beauty in this life and in the world to come. But we ask that you meet us here. We pray that your word will be fulfilled in our hearing and that your Spirit will fill us with courage as together we pray now a prayer of confession. Please join me. Ever gracious God, from generation to generation, you call forth your faithful women and men to be willing servants of truth. You fill us with strength and hope. Yet we find it is often not enough. We pray for both great faith and for easy lives, but we know these things seldom exist together. We pray only to avoid the time of trial, when we also need to pray for strength and confidence to face the challenges that come with faithfulness. So forgive us, God, for our limited vision and our feeble trust. Make us strong like Stephen, so that we may pray and rejoice in your unending grace, even in the times of deepest suffering. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Beloved friends, do not let your hearts be troubled, but share instead in Stephen's vision of heavens opened up and Christ standing at the right hand of God. This glorious vision of hope is for us all, for we are forgiven of all that separates us from the Holy One. Blessed be God, the giver of life, and the blessed be God's people who rejoice in Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. May we celebrate God's vision through the virtual passing of peace with one another now.
Good morning, St. John's. It's so good to see everybody. It's a beautiful day. The sun is out shining and we can be out and about. I miss everybody. Can't wait to get back into the sanctuary, but until then, I'm enjoying talking to some of you. And feel free, anybody, if you feel like you'd like to give me a call, I'd love to hear from anybody. Other than that, I hope you're watching the virtual services online. They're very nice. And I can't wait to get back into the sanctuary and see everybody again. Until then, be safe and take care. Bye.
Hi, everyone. I hope you're doing well this Mother's Day Sunday. I've been doing well, hunkered down here at home and working from home for the past few weeks, like I know many of you have. On Friday the 13th of March, I actually adopted a new puppy. He was about 10, 11 pounds when I got him, and now he's closing in on 21, so he's been growing like a weed. He's a little German Shepherd Terrier mix, and he's keeping me quite busy around the house, especially trying to see what he can get into and as he learns. So can't wait to see all of you again, and I hope you're doing well. See you soon. Bye.
Our lesson today is a New Testament epistle that is coming as the first letter of Peter, chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Rid yourselves, therefore, of all malice and all guile, insincerity, envy, and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying a stone in Zion, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, then, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of the darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God."
We are addicted to the building, we are addicted to the programs, we are addicted to the system, and we want to change. And that's one of the things in talking with pastors, that it just comes out that, yeah, we're addicted to that. What would we do if we didn't do that? what would we do if we really got out of our offices and spent most of our time outside the building? What would our people do? It's just the way we define ourselves, that, you know, that container. And I love the concept that Barbara Brown Taylor has in Altar in the World. It's a fantastic book. And she said, you know, the whole world is the house of God. And she talks about Jacob and the experience of being at Bethel and, you know, laying the stone under his head, had no idea how God was going to show up in that way. These theophanies, these openings in the portal of heaven. And, you know, seeing the angels come up and down this ladder and his realization that, wow, I just experienced God here. The temple hadn't been built. And he, the stone that he'd used it as his pillow, you became the altar to that experience. But what we do then is we use that stone as the cornerstone, build a building around it, fossilize the experience, and build our whole lives around this experience, and then forget the rest of the world. And she talks about the whole world is so full of altars. In other words, so full of the portals of God coming through all the time, you know, through people in our lives and angels showing up, God showing up everywhere. But we are not looking. The people of God are not looking because God is supposed to show up in the building, and God is supposed to show up in our programs and everything that we create. And I wonder what would happen if the people of God stopped looking for the things that, where they could create the God experience and simply affirm God in people's lives in the everyday. I mean, I have conversations, the last 12 years being with unchurched people, I have conversations with people who talk about God showing up. They talk about the little kid on the corner who's selling a piece of art that he made with broken glass. He's homeless, and his mom has medical problems, and he wants to pay for treatment. And they call that, I mean, they met this angel on the corner. Or my friend who's a photographer, National Geographic photographer, 25 years on the field. So photojournalism all over the world. And he sends me pictures of the people, the faces, the huts, the places where people are living in poverty and trash heaps, and the beauty out of their faces. He just sent me one this week. And it was at the bottom of a waterfall, and he pointed the camera in such a way that the colors were just a kaleidoscope, and the water was exploding. And here he is, he says, and he's not a Christian, and intentionally not, and he said, I see angels in this waterfall, and it just makes me weep. And that goes back to a story of him being in Upper Ontario on a canoe trip and having an experience with God, and this whole story that unfolded about end times and all this. And he has those all the time. But we're so used to saying, well, that doesn't matter. That your spiritual experience is not real until we can ritualize it, until we can, you know, fit it into our system. We can fit it into, you know, this thing. And, wow, we're missing it. I mean, I wanted to be in listening mode, which is why I've spent the last 12 years, you know, basically outside the church. I wanted to listen more. And this is what I'm hearing. You know, and people say, well, you know, we want to bring people to church so they can experience God. You know, I think people want to connect with us so they can tell their own God stories. And so they can see, they can get the light in our eyes, they can get the yes. That, oh yeah, you know God too. And they don't know them in the way that we think that they should know God. But am I going to tell somebody, no, that wasn't God. Am I in charge of those portals? So I love that concept, and we can make this real in the church, that we find out what God is doing. We find out where God is showing up, and we go there. This is what Jesus did, isn't he?
Friends, please pray with me. God, I ask today that the words of my mouth and the meditation on all our hearts be pleasing to you, for it is you who is our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So, do any of you have any recollection of the milkman? I know some of the younger folks probably won't, but, and I'm dating myself, but I remember the milkman coming to my Grandma Mare's house. She had one of those old-fashioned ice boxes. It wasn't one that was in the house. It was actually a door on the exterior of the house, on the back porch, built into the house. And the milkman would deliver and open up the ice box where there was a chunk of ice and put glass milk bottles in. For those of you who have seen probably Oberweis or the glass milk bottles, that's what they delivered the milk in. That was old-fashioned milk delivery. And I have quite fond memories of that from when I was a kid, because I spent a lot of time at both my grandparents' homes. But I thought of that when I was doing this reading today, because our reading from Peter today has him likening us to newborn babies who crave that spiritual milk so that we'll grow up, right? And Peter tells the early church and tells us, too, that milk has its purpose and it's good, right? It's pretty good, actually. But we hear, too, that God wants more for us. Peter continues on in verse 4, saying, "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, chosen by God and precious to him." Here, referring to Jesus as the living stone. Did you know that the word for building with brick and stone actually comes from the Greek word Legos? Yes, Legos. That's where the name for those building blocks that the kids like to play with, kids of all ages, actually, myself included. I love building things with Legos. See, now Peter here actually uses a variation of that word in the original text in reference to Jesus. And he continues, "You also," referring to those in the developing church, "you also are like..." "You also are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood," he says. Now, there are a whole lot of non-literal references to the stones, or to stones in general, in Scripture. And in reference to that rock-solid, sure love of God that we know and we talk about all the time, right? But I can think of only two exceptions in particular that would be aside from that. One would be when Jesus refers to Peter as the rock, right? And even when I say my prayer before I speak to you from a pulpit, I remind us that it is God who is our rock, right? And Jesus, our Redeemer. But that rock is referring to the foundation, right? The foundation of the church as our Christian movement. And then in this text, when he's actually referring to all of us, those of us who make up the church, those who are the living stones, right? Now, personally, I'd like to think in reference to things that are living would be more like things that draw breath, or they move, or they grow in some way. And stones don't, right? So we can understand that the use of this particular image is meant to be used as a metaphor and not to be interpreted literally, which you've heard me say before. But I really want you to hear and feel a sense of comfort in this letter today from Peter. Comfort for us now, as it's very real that we've been suffering, and perhaps in different ways, but we're all experiencing a variety of different forms of grief. And disappointment, hurt, and even frustration. Yes, real frustration. I have no doubt. I'm not the only one. I've been on so many Zoom calls that I think I do have what they're now calling Zoom fatigue. If you've heard that, I've probably got it to a certain degree. My eyes get tired being in front of a computer screen all the time. Apparently there's some kind of special glasses that I can get to help with that. They're not these, but we'll look into that. In any case, this physical distancing, right, and self-isolation and quarantine really can't be minimized because it is an authentic form of suffering for us all. There's this quote that I came across from Bishop Tom Wright of Oxford. He states, "There's a reason we normally try to meet in the flesh. There's a reason solitary confinement is such a severe punishment, right? We can't tick off the days here. This is a stillness, not of rest, but of poised, anxious sorrow. And indeed, it is a sorrow that we're all experiencing." But again, this letter, this epistle from Peter today is addressed to a group of early churches that are actually alienated from surrounding society and feeling threatened, actually. And it is intended as a means of comfort to them, which is why it can offer us some good pearls of wisdom today, I think. This epistle reminds us as believers of what it means to live out the sacraments as individuals and as a community. He's providing them with a means to live faithfully, despite the fact that they are restricted from gathering publicly. Interesting little bit of trivia there, huh? He tells them to spend their time despite their distress and renewing their relationship with Christ, just as we now all need to learn to live into a new sense of normal. One of the ways that I hope that we will make meaning of this time of suffering is to renew that our identity is in fact in Christ. As a community, we have been committed to this revitalization effort with the support of our conference. And this current crisis has not changed that. In fact, our team will be meeting again via Zoom later this week, and I hope to talk to them about the idea of resilience as a part of that revitalization. This community knows of resilience. We've experienced much trauma, even recently, as it related to the accident that took place in our church building in our sanctuary. But there were things that we learned about ourselves individually and collectively through that time. And there are things now that we're learning, maybe even more things through this experience about who we are as a community and as individuals. This video that I had you watch before my reflection today made reference of a book titled An Altar in the World by Barbara Brown Taylor. Now, you know, I was fortunate to meet Barbara Brown Taylor this last year, and she is an absolutely remarkable theologian, and she's written a lot of books. And one of the books that I'm hoping to recommend to our book club is titled An Altar of the World. In the world. And I think this book will show us kind of how to discover that altars are everywhere we go and in nearly everything that we do. So in light of all that we've been experiencing, I'm excited and eager to continue having some real meaningful conversations in our book club with this particular book, because I know it's going to be a rich resource as we reflect together about the altars in the world and our own spirituality, even exploring what that spirituality is. So I had an opportunity this past week to hear Rabbi Dr. Rachel Mikva. She was one of my very favorite seminary professors. I took a number of classes from her. And she shared a reflection with the seminary community this past week And I am super excited about it because it's given me a lot of food for sermons, right? So there's more to come that I'm not going to share with you today. But suffice it to say that there's a lot in our Bible, right? In the Hebrew text that we refer to often as the Old Testament, the Hebrew texts of Job and Ruth are incredibly rich books about resilience. So there will be much to come from that. But the thing that I wanted to share with you today that I was reminded of by Rabbi Mikvah was that as some of our traditions may vary, we are reminded that in both Judaism and Christianity, there's a lot that we share, and that each of those broader traditions teach us that we are loved both eternally and unconditionally. I'm going to try to recite two Hebrew blessings, so if you're patient with me, hopefully I'll be able to do so successfully. The first one is Ahava Rabba Ahava Ahav Tanu. Jews recite this in their daily prayers. Ahava Rabba Ahav Tanu. And it means, with a great love you envelop us, O God. And the other one is, there is always hope. Baruch Ma'avir Afeila Yumavi Ora, which means, blessed is the one who helps the darkness to pass and reveals the light. See, each tradition throughout history demonstrated profound resilience that required people to work together to guide one another through a process of adapting, really. And as part of our own efforts to revitalize, just as we have similarly restored our building this last year and have engaged in the work of identifying some of the things that we most value, and even articulating that collective identity as we have this past year, now we need to continue that work together in new ways in order to preserve it. And that may mean that we'll need to relinquish some ideas or habits or things that are just not sustainable or even equitable in this environment. So it will also mean, the better part of that is that we'll have opportunity to restore some things that may have somehow been set aside or even lost. And I think today's epistle from Peter reminds us of just that it is our job as a community of faith to show the world what it means to love others in this hurting world, to show God's love to others in this hurting world. Now, there was a 16th century mystic named Teresa of Avila from Spain. I think she calls to us now, even in this 21st century, saying, Christ has no body now on earth but yours, no hands but yours, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes through which Christ's compassion is to look out to the earth. Yours are the feet by which he is to go about doing good, and yours are the hands by which he is to bless us now. So, beloved friends, we are to become living stones. We are to allow ourselves to be built into a community to serve as Christ's eyes, ears, hands, and feet. We are chosen, as Peter tells us. So may we bring compassion and love and blessing to others by our words and our actions, each and every day moving forward. May it be so. Amen. Beloved friends, Let us prepare our hearts and minds for a time of prayer on this special Mother's Day. We ask Almighty Holy One, our Heavenly Father, our Mother and God, who is beyond our understanding yet is deep within our hearts. Today, this day especially, we cry out to you as your beloved children. We bring before you all that we are, our sorrow, our pain, our hope, and our joy. Today we celebrate our mothers, those who bore us and cradled us as infants. We also remember mothers who have lost their children through illness or violence, whose tears still flow from their broken hearts. For we cherish our families, those who have sheltered us from harm and who have provided us our daily meals. We remember our families, those families in particular who are separated, and those who are exiled from their place of birth, whether it's by frontiers or barbed wire or by war's violence. We express our thankfulness to our spiritual mothers and fathers who have guided us throughout life, modeling for us the love of God. We hold up mothers of diverse religions and creeds who experience life in disparate ways, those who are comforted and encouraged by what they believe, and those who struggle to find meaning and hope in their faith. We pray for those who we love and hold dear to our hearts, our children, youth, young adults, and elders. And we pray for those we know and do not hold dear, and those we do not know, and those who suffer that we have not embraced. Now, on this Mother's Day especially, we come to be in worship together with a living, still speaking God, to honor our mothers of all forms and varieties, and to find our solace and peace in the goodness that life brings. Even amidst our isolation and quarantine, we acknowledge both the joys and the sorrows of life. We hope to depart from our time transformed by Christ's Spirit, that we may express compassion, seek justice, show mercy, and pursue peace wherever our lives may lead. As we together share in the words of prayer given to us by Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those debts against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let us permit ourselves to be living vessels of God's sweet, sweet Spirit by offering ourselves, our lives, and our gifts to those who are most in need of Christ's healing mercy. God, we ask your blessing on our offerings today, that they may heal and make whole the lives of all your children. Bless those who give and those who long to give, that we may become living stones of mercy, grace, and justice in the house of your creation. Amen. Beloved friends, once we were just a people, but now you are a people bound together by God's mercy and united in Christ's service. Depart from our digital, virtual time together in peace and in confidence to love and serve in the name of Jesus the Christ, the living representation of God in our midst. And now let all God's people say, Amen.